Sunrise, he burned me, sun dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings the fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. So carry your candle into the darkness. Seek out the hopeless, confusing torn. Pour out your candle for all to see.
And the scent is tickling my throat, so I'm gonna keep my hands away from you. morning, and welcome to worship on this beautiful Labor Day weekend. It's so good to see you all. There's a few things coming up I want to make sure you know about. In 2 weeks, we're going to have ice cream and lawn games, so I hope you just plan on staying a little bit after church to have some fun and connect on the 19th. And this Saturday, it's happening. This Saturday is the second Saturday, and we're just so excited to have kids here and to be teaching them about Jesus and the Bible. Alex is ready to go. We're all excited. I'm going to be the floater. I'll be like, where am I needed? And that's what I'm going to do. So thanks to all of you who are helping out, and we look forward to reporting back next Sunday on how that goes. And, oh, just a final thing. Circle of friends. Yeah, we're going putt-putt golfing. I'm pretty mean with the putter, so game on, people. That's at the end of September. We're hoping for a nice day at the end of September. So, on that note, why don't we greet each other? Just continue to respect each other's distances, and let's pass the peace of Christ this morning.
Nice to have a visitor.
Yes.
Peace be with you. Yep, here we are again.
Yes, peace.
If you're able to remain standing for our call to worship, please do. Today's I Am statement is, I am the resurrection and the life. So let's join together in our call. This is the good news which we proclaim to you.
Jesus Christ is raised from the dead.
Walk in the light of his love.
Live in the light of his teachings and healing mercies.
Come, let us worship the one who overcame death.
Let us celebrate the triumph of our Lord.
Thank you.
It goes like this. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are noble. In whom is all my delight? Those who choose another God multiply their sorrows. They drink offerings of blood I will not pour out, or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night, also, my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. Do you not give me up to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit? You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. What we've been learning about the I am statements of Jesus is that John pairs these statements always with a story, or an event. And it's the same with I am the resurrection and the life, the event. Is it chilly today?
Yes.
It is chilly.
Yes.
Somebody want to take a pencil? I think actually the box comes off and turn up the AC. Oh, Alex is going to do it. Thank you, Alex. If I'm chilly, I know you're chilly, because I'm always hot, so we'll warm it up a little bit for you. The occasion of the I am statement, I am the resurrection of the life, was the death of one of Jesus' closest friends, Lazarus. It was a devastating loss, both to Jesus and to Lazarus' family, his precious sisters, Mary and Martha. And this story, I think, it captures our experience with death. Because here's the thing, we all know it's coming. We all know that death is a part of life. Birth and death, those are the things that unite us as human beings. And yet, even though we know this truth, we're never quite ready when it comes. The loss of someone precious to us is devastating. So I want to do a show of hands just to see where our experience is with losing people to death. If you have lost a parent, how about both parents? All right. How about a spouse? All right. How about a friend? All of us. How about a child?
Grandchild.
Oh,
grandchild.
I'm so sorry. And I had to put this in. A pet.
Yeah.
Like, but you know, that is a death experience, especially if you have children in the house. We're never quite ready for death when it comes. And this is what happened in John chapter 11. You may know this about Lazarus and Mary and Martha, but they were really good friends of Jesus. We find him in their home a number of times, having dinner, hanging out. There's this sense in scripture that their home was actually a refuge for Jesus, a place he could go to get away from it all. And in John chapter 11, Lazarus gets sick. And Jesus is not in town. He's out preaching and teaching and doing his thing. So the sisters, Mary and Martha, send a message to him. And the message is, the one you love, Lord, he whom you love is ill. In other words, we need you, Jesus. And up to this point, this family knew Jesus' healing power. They knew what he could do, and they knew he loved them. The one you love is ill. And Jesus does the, to us it's kind of bizarre, like, what, Jesus? He doesn't go. When he gets the note, he doesn't go. He waits 2 days, and then he goes. And when he gets there, Lazarus has already been dead for 4 days. John 11:17. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. This is significant, and here's why. In Jewish tradition, it was believed that the spirit remained with the body for 3 days. So when Jesus rose from the dead, it was after 3 days. In fact, there's a lot of three-day things in the Bible. It's kind of a thing. So the sense that Jesus came back, you know, his spirit was still with him, that all made sense in the Jewish death timeline. Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. There was no hope. Day four means no hope. Not only is his body gone, his spirit has left him. So Jesus gets to their home and finds a hopeless hole with a stone rolled over it, a hopeless family, a hopeless crowd. Friends had flooded from Jerusalem to mourn with them. There was a crowd there. Their little town of Bethany was just a couple miles outside of Jerusalem, which of course was the central city. So he comes 4 days beyond hope. When Martha heard Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Remember, Martha was the one that was busy in the kitchen while Mary sat at Jesus' feet to learn. Martha's the one watching and runs out to greet him. And the first thing out of her mouth, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Subtext, where the hell have you been? Where the hell were you? If you had been here, he wouldn't have died, Jesus. And Jesus says to her, "Your brother will rise again." Now, Martha took this to mean, what she says is, "Well, I know he's going to rise again in the resurrection on the last day." She took this to mean, it was a traditional statement of comfort. "Your brother will rise again." It's like we would say, you know they're in heaven now. Or we would say, their suffering is over. It was that kind of a line. Jesus said, "Your brother will rise again." She thought he was just offering her a cliche, a traditional statement when someone dies. But he wasn't. She says, "Well, I know he's going to rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And here's where Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" And Martha said, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." Side note, this is the second time in John that someone has confessed Jesus to be the Messiah. Two women, the woman at the well and Martha. Go, John. "I am the resurrection and the life." Here's another interesting thing. There are early manuscripts that were transcribed from the original manuscripts that omit the word "and the life." They just have Jesus say, "I am the resurrection." You've got scribes, right? Picture the little monk or whoever, the little monk in his little cubby transcribing the scripture. And he comes along, "I am the resurrection and the life." And the scribe thinks, "Well, that's redundant." And they save themselves a couple words. Apparently someone thought that "I am the resurrection and the life" was redundant and meant the same thing. But when you look at what Jesus says, "Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." He's not just talking about life after death. He's also talking about living. "I am the resurrection and the life." It's not redundant. Jesus is talking about both now and then. If you live now and believe in me, you're not going to die. And if you die and believe in me, you're going to live. It's now and then. Life now was relevant to Jesus. I grew up in Sunday school. It was all about the afterlife. Do you guys remember that? It was always about eternal life. You know, you need to trust Jesus so you don't go to hell and you're going to have eternal life with Christ. It was always about the then. But for Jesus, it's also very, very much about the now. "I am the resurrection and the life." Because we're never ready for them. We're never quite ready for death. And how comforting to know that Jesus actually does care about. So he goes into the house, and Mary's there. And when he greets Mary, he weeps. He weeps with her. The shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. This is where it is. He wept. And we don't know why. Did he weep because Lazarus was dead? Did he weep because he saw the grief of Mary and Martha and it just moved him? Did he weep because he wished he could have been there? Like, he regret that he wasn't there? We don't know, but we know he shared their grief with them. And Mary says the same thing. Where the hell were you? If you had been here, my brother would not have died. And he said, take me to where you laid him. And they took him out to the tomb. And in this amazing moment, the crowd, the mourners have gathered. The tomb is sealed. It's been 4 days. And when Jesus said, roll the stone away, they looked at him like, Jesus, it is not going to smell good in there. I mean, it was a very practical worry. I mean, he is really gone. What are you thinking? And they rolled the stone away, and Jesus called his name. That hopeless hole, on that hopeless day with that hopeless crowd, he called his name, and Lazarus came walking out. Life now. Lazarus was raised, not to eternal life, but life now. I am the resurrection and the life. Pierre and I got some rough news yesterday that I want to share with you. And I think this is the place to share it because it's what we're talking about. Many of you remember the Beller family. Joel was on our staff. They divorced, and we have remained very good friends with Scott, and they have 3 boys. Charlie's in college now, Will and Josh, high school. Josh was in a wheelchair. He had a very severe brain injury at birth, and Josh was found in his bed yesterday morning. He had gotten caught on something in his bed, and he could not be revived. Scott got the word. Scott was out hiking when he got the call, and he texted us, and we called him, and we don't know the details, but what we know is that they're devastated. This wasn't a death that was meant to be. You know, Josh always lived a life that was tenuous. He would keep in close to death countless times in his life. Every time he got sick, there was the worry he wouldn't keep breathing. And yet when death comes, we're never ready, are we? They weren't ready for this. Mary and Martha weren't ready for this. None of us, when we lose someone, even a parent that's old, it's not like we're ready for it, even though we know it's a part of life. Jesus cares about our life now. When he rose on the 3rd day, he wanted us to know that he's got power over death, that we don't have to be afraid of what comes next. We don't have to be afraid of the then that's coming. Because he rose. But then we have the raising of Lazarus. And the timing is so incredible. The raising of Lazarus happens just a few weeks before Jesus' own resurrection. It's a foreshadowing of the power of life that is to come. Jesus rose to the life that comes next. But Lazarus rose to life now. He was given back his life. So when we hear these words of Jesus, you know, these are the words we say at funerals because they're words of comfort. I am the resurrection and the life. And we think about life after death. But the life part is not redundant. It's actually about life right now. Jesus had to say is, it's not hopeless. Look at what I can do after 4 days. So this is for us. If you have ever felt hopeless, and I know you have, because we all have. If you have ever felt like you have, your dreams have failed, or your joy has been lost, or you are in grief, or suffering without hope with an illness, this is the message. There is always hope. There is always hope for life now. Jesus wants us to embrace life now because he is with us and he is ready to call your name and help you move out of whatever hopeless hole you might be in into the sun and the light that is life. Will you pray with me? Lord God, our hearts are broken for Scott and Joelle and for Charlie and Will with the loss of Josh. And we ask that today, as they go about their days, God, steeped in this grief, that they will know your great love and your presence with them. Help us, God, believe in the life you offer, especially when we are feeling hopeless. It's through Christ we pray. Amen.
Those able, we invite you to please stand and sing with us.
For our blessings. Will you say a prayer with me? Lord God, we have been blessed, and it's our desire to be a blessing. So take what we give, God, and use it for the love and your love spread in the life of this church and our many ministries. Through Christ we pray. Amen. To our closing hymn, we will now sing Santo Santo in preparation for communion. We can do it a cappella too. Thanks, Linda. Yeah, we don't mind getting old up here. sometimes we do forget things. I know you don't know what that's like. Are you ready? Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath. Would you join me in reading our prayer of confession today? Forgive those things we have done which have caused you sadness, and those things we should have done that would have brought you joy. In both we have failed, ourselves and you. Bring us back to that place where our journey began, where we said that we would follow the way first trod. Lead us to the cross and lead us there. Friends, this table is the Lord's table, and all those who trust in him and believe in his name are invited to share in this meal which he has prepared. Today you are invited to come to the Lord's table. Lord God, this morning we ask that you would send your blessing onto this table and that your spirit would come into this bread and cup so that you might meet us here and fill us anew with your love and your grace, your forgiveness and your power. Through Christ we pray. Amen. On the very night of his betrayal, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant, which is sealed in my blood. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of Christ until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for us, the people of God. As always, you're invited to come forward down the side aisles as you feel led. We have individual cups, and the very top layer is the bread, and then we peel again, and it's the cup. So I'd like you to get it and hold it, and we will take the bread and cup together after we've all been seated. This bread is the bread of life. Grace and love and power.